Hi, my name is Tim Hoffman. I am the shop manager at Amerisource Specialty Products. We deal with carbon and graphite for electric arc furnaces. With graphite, they use it to either melt down steel or heat large furnaces. Graphite can take a lot of heat or very corrosive material. So they use it to line pipes that have acid go through it. Here at Amerisource, we produce the parts that go either in the furnaces or for whatever kind of corrosive or thermo application that they need. I'm 28 years old. I've been machining for about 12 years, and working here has been good. The graphite industry is not a bad thing to work in. We have 5-axis machine capabilities. We do mostly turning. Small diameters is our specialty. We have competitive 401k, healthcare. Our pay is like anywhere from $12 to $18 an hour based on experience. And I've only worked here about a year, so you can move up in the company quickly if you succeed.
Hi, my name is Tom Maxwell, and I'm with DieQuip Corporation. We are a manufacturer of internal grinding and polishing machines that are used to make the die or the tool that is used to make wire, bar, and tubing. At our factory, we do machining and assembly work of these machines. Our ideal candidate is someone that comes with some machining schooling or some mechanical background. We will do a lot of teaching, but we need them to have the basics and more so the right personality, which is that they're not afraid of math, that they are a self-starter, and that they are analytical, creative, and not just someone coming in as people used to think of a machine shop as just a dirty, heavy place to work. All the stuff we do is very light and is in a very pretty clean environment. But we need you to be able to think outside the box and be able to come up with good ideas on solving problems. Since we do a lot of custom work, it is not just a production line of building machines. So machining is not what a lot of people's perception is. It is not a big, dirty industry of the 1970s in a steel mill. As you can see behind me, we have a number of CNC machines. We design the parts in Inventor, in a 3D modeling environment. That is then sent to a CAM system to be able to program, or sent directly to the machine to be able to start making the part. This takes creativity. This also takes skill to be able to work with software, not only on a computer, but work in software on the machine, make those adjustments so that the parts come out the way that we need to fit together. So one of the reasons I think you should consider looking into the trades is when you look at going to school, the trades are going to be very quick, and you're going to be able to get out and start working quickly. The debt that you are going to incur is going to be very small. In fact, normally it is a fraction of even a brand new car. When you compare that to starting to go to universities, even just a local state college, if you don't have parents that are able to help you, you could be incurring $100,000 in debt for a general business or marketing degree. And you are one of thousands of kids graduating every year in the state of Pennsylvania that are now competing for those same entry-level positions. If you start looking at schools like Pitt and Carnegie Mellon, you could be coming out with debt over $200,000 a year. And the question you have to ask yourself is, how do you justify paying that kind of money in, say, 5 years after graduating, as compared to if you went into a trade that in a matter of maybe a year and a half or 2 years, you're already working and starting to advance by the time these kids are just getting out of college. And unfortunately, anymore, it is very difficult to even graduate from university within the 4 years. So now if you start looking at adding a fifth year, you're adding yet another $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 to that debt. The trades now give you that opportunity to get out there, start a life, work in a rewarding career, but also be in a much better financial condition than those that are coming out of university that do not have assistance from their parents. Manufacturing is not going away in the United States. you'd be surprised, almost every hobby or everything that you do has a part in it that was machined or made by somebody. So for that reason, there are currently tons of opportunities for employment within the manufacturing industry. In fact, I had recently seen a study where that over 70% of the people in the machining industry are above 45 years old. So we're having a very high retirement rate, which is leaving a lot of unfilled positions. Almost every manufacturer that I know is looking for people within the skilled trades, whether it be electrical, mechanical, or machining. One of the misconceptions about electrical is that it's all building houses or wiring buildings. Here, we actually do industrial electronics. So sitting at a table, being able to use tools to run wires to component parts, and then those component parts quite often need programmed. So we're gonna have to take and hook this up to a computer to dump programs that we've had to write on how the PLC or the variable frequency drives will work. So when we're looking for employees, unfortunately, the perception in a lot of the schools today is that the trades are for those people that cannot make it in college. And that is just not true. We need to have very intelligent, very skilled people going into the trades to be able to successfully make the products that we make. Without having these skilled people that are creative and talented, we are not able to continue doing what we do. And unfortunately, the industry has lost so many of those people from retirement that we are now in a desperate need for good quality people going into the trades. An example of a highly skilled and talented tradesman is Jesse Exler. He not only works for me, but he has his own business called Jex Manufacturing, where he designs and machines parts for not only customers, but for products that he's come up with himself.
What we're doing here is we're creating this part, which I was hired to make. So what I do is I take this material, which is 416 stainless steel, and I have to get this part out of this material. So the way I do it is I draw the part up in 3D in parametrics in the computer, and then I write the program in the computer so I can mill it in the CNC milling machine. So this is basically subtractive manufacturing. You took sculpture in art class, then you know what I'm talking about. So you take a part. This part is already in this material. But what I have to do is get the material around the part out of the way, so what I end up with is the actual part itself.
So it's people like Jesse that somebody like myself is looking to hire. This is someone that is creative, that has learned the basics of his skill, and then applied those skills, not just standing in front of a machine, but trying new ideas, trying things differently, learning from his mistakes, instead of just accepting the status quo, compared to working on some of these old machines that were that way. You were given a part, you made some holes in it, you made some slots in it, and then you went to the next part. We now need those kids that are getting good grades in classes like physics and math and art class, even, as you heard him talking about, that have an interest in being able to make something with your hands and your mind at the same time. Not just turning handles like this old machine, but programming. So any of your STEM classes, if you enjoy those types of things, this is the type of people that we're looking for. So if you're one of those people, I would strongly encourage you to give the trades a look as a profession. It is a great profession. It can lead you into many different directions, from not only someone like myself that's a machine builder, but somebody making parts for a lot of different applications in the medical industry, the aerospace industry. So it has a lot of positives and could use a lot of very high quality people.
Hello, I'm Tim Mowry, and I'm president and CEO of Vericheck Technical Services. You'll meet some members of our team today, and they're going to talk a little bit about what we do as a company and what opportunities we have for the community of Bethel Park. I, too, am a 1980 graduate of Bethel Park High School. At this time, I'd like to introduce Jeff Rachel, who is the CFO and Vice President of Finance for Vericheck.
Hi, I'm Jeff Frachel. I'm the Vice President and CFO at Verichek Technical Services. I graduated from Bethel Park in 2006. I went to Robert Morris University, and I'm currently head of the financial department here at Verichek Technical Services. I've been here since 2011 and worked my way through the financial area.
All right. My name is Matt Mullen. I am the sales and service manager of Verichek Technical Services. I graduated from Bethel Park in 2005. I am also a Robert Morris graduate. I graduated with a computer information systems degree here, started as an IT internship, and continued to work my way through the company. I now manage all service and sales activities that come through Verichek.
My name is Jared Karenbauer. I went to Bethel Park High School and graduated in 2007. I followed that up with Robert Morris University for business management. I am currently the sales and service coordinator at Verichek Technical Services. I started in the inventory department, worked my way up from there. I handle all the service scheduling and a lot of the service quoting.
My name is Evan Sivitz. I am the Vice President and Chief Operations Officer of Verichek Technical Services. I manage the quality department as well as service and sales. I work hand-in-hand with Matt Mullen and Marco DeGasperi to make sure things are running smoothly here at Verichek. We're here in the service shop of Verichek, and this is where we specialize and do in-house testing as well as service, repair, calibration of the OES or optical emission spectrometers. The one thing that sets Verichek apart is our ISO accreditation. So we are an ISO 17025 accredited laboratory for calibration and testing. So we are able to have written procedures, provide customers with quality support and services to keep them up and running, and we have this facility here to do so. The main type of education that we're looking for, and we hire through Pittsburgh Technical College, and we do an internship program with them annually, and that is one of the main places that we go through for our hiring and onboarding. All right, so Verichek Technical Services has been around for over 25 years. We've started in a small basement and have grown our way to a 20-man operation here in Bethel Park. We are looking for young, motivated people that are interested in engineering, electrical engineering specifically, as well as an interest in metals identification. We have quite an opportunity here, and we look forward to anyone that's interested in the engineering field, electrical engineering, as well as metals.
Marco DeGasperi, I am a 2000 graduate of Thomas Jefferson High School, followed that up with West Virginia University, and then went to Pittsburgh Technical Institute, now Pittsburgh Technical College. Here at Verichek, I am the technical director. I am in charge of all of the training protocols, all of the written instruction for all repairs and service to any of the instruments, as well as managing the entire team of service engineers, which we are currently and constantly looking to hire and bring on new, excited, driven individuals. As part of that, we do prefer a two-year degree. It is extremely difficult at this point to find individuals who have the capabilities and have not been to a four-year college, but actually have the skilled trade. Part of that program is an internship. I started myself as an intern here, and over the last 6 years have risen up to the technical manager point of view. A little bit about what these instruments do and where they go. You'll have to follow me into our demonstration lab. Basically what we do here is that we sell, service, and analyze metal analysis equipment. Basically, if anybody that works here with us, what they're going to do, the first thing they're going to learn is how to test metals. Why do we test metals? Well, one of the most important factors of any metal is that what is it made out of? And the companies that buy this equipment or utilize this equipment or utilize our services for testing, they want to know if a certain element or a certain grouping of elements is too high or too low. If they become too high or too low, then the entire surface, the entire steel itself could become compromised. Examples such as, the Liberty Bridge, after the fire, why did those steel buckle? It was the wrong alloy. what we look at is very fine concentrations, sometimes down to 0.005% of a material. This is absolutely crucial in the metals making processes. To a greater point is that foundries and other companies don't want to pay for us to test all of their material all day long. They're testing sometimes 70, 80 different pieces of material a day. So what they'll do is they'll buy their own equipment, and then it's up to us to service yearly on a preventative maintenance scale. And then anything that may go wrong with the instrumentation, we have to be there in the drop of a dime. If this instrumentation goes down in a foundry, it will shut down an entire mill until this one piece of equipment is fixed. So yeah, this is a test burn on how a piece of equipment like this would work. You have a sample here, it goes through an argon purge, and then you can hear that high voltage spark. What the instrument's actually doing at this point is that through a 360 volt spark, it's causing the excitement of the outer valence electron shell. And what that does is release the wavelengths. The instrument, in fact, is not actually measuring the material. It's measuring the amount of light off of the material. And then it populates an analysis right there.
Okay, so this is a typical instrument, a mobile instrument that we have here at Verichek Technical Services. Our customers use mobile application in their facility to go from different types of metals or different type of production areas to do testing and perform analysis on what they're producing. We have an instrument that's opened up here that we will do repairs to, clean the instrument for our annual PMs and calibrations, and then we have the instrument with its full cover on it. And again, these are instruments that there's three different types of instruments that we have on site. We will have a mobile application with these on wheels, we will have a laboratory application that you saw with Marco, and we have a handheld application as well.
Okay, what we have here is one of our handheld units. This instrument in particular is using a different type of test method. This is actually using an X-ray fluorescence to test for the same elemental content. But in this case, you're not going to get as precise analysis, and as opposed to be utilized in foundries which were actually producing the metal, this is more used in your scrap yards where they need to sort out different metals that might have an element in it that is worth a little more money than some of the other ones, so that they can sort it all out and on their end determine what they can melt together, what they can't melt together, and who might actually buy something that's a little more expensive than, say, just your common grade steel or aluminum.
Okay, so you are now in Verichek's instrumentation room. This is another offering that Verichek has that we use our service engineers to prepare. We have refurbished instrumentation. Instruments may be 10, 12, 15 years old that Verichek is able to continue to service, calibrate, and repair as with our large spare parts department and our service department's years of knowledge. So we offer these on our website. We have a mobile application, we have laboratory applications, as well as the handheld applications. And these are cost-effective solutions for our customers not looking to buy new instrumentation. Okay, so we are here with some of the older instrumentation that Verichek has. As the metals industry, and specifically the metals testing industry, has changed, so has the instrumentation. We have gone from larger instrumentation like this spectro test, spectroport instrumentation behind me, to smaller mobile instrumentation with better analysis. So the industry is constantly developing and constantly changing, so that we, Verichek, continue to stay on top of things, and we continue to offer better testing instruments, higher quality testing instruments. And this is sort of the history of instrumentation here, where we have some older instrumentation, much larger, heavier instruments, not so easy to move, to some easier instrumentation from a testing standpoint and from a mobility standpoint.
Here at Verichek, we start our technical engineers off at near $40,000 a year. They have an opportunity for growth. There's a commission paid based on some of the work they do. There's opportunity to get into other aspects of the business. But we have people that are making very good money here who just have a few years' experience.
So here at Verichek, our ideal candidate, what we're looking for in a young man or woman in this field is someone who's highly motivated, somebody who wants to travel the world, because working for this company, you can travel the world. Somebody that isn't opposed to driving a couple hours, maybe one of the days that you work here, you might just travel 3 or 4 hours up to New York City. We're also looking for somebody that is hands-on, somebody that is okay with getting in and replacing components, replacing boards. Maybe somebody that has a technical background in the electronic discipline or the electrical discipline. The possibilities are limitless. However, a simple college degree is not going to do it for us, because if you've just been sitting around being taught how to do mathematics, that's not going to work for us. What I need is somebody that's actually been taught to use their hands, to work with their hands, somebody that wants to not sit at a desk 24 hours a day, but somebody that wants to travel around, to work, to actually explore and see new places, new things.
Well, we thank you for visiting Verichek today. We hope you learned a lot about our people, a little bit about what they do and what opportunities exist here. It's a great chance for somebody to come in that may not be interested in going for a four-year degree. Somebody that with a two-year degree through one of the technical colleges has a great opportunity for growth, advancement, travel, seeing different industries, going into foundries, going into car plants, and really seeing what the metals are being used for. So we appreciate you taking time, and we're looking for a number of candidates to come in as interns and grow with our business.
How are you doing? I'm Matt from General Manufacturing Company. We're a defense contracting business with a high production volume machine shop. We have horizontal milling machines, vertical milling machines, lathe turn, CMM measuring equipment. We also have a design area for CAD design, which we turn into a final product, which most of that product goes into the United States government. We also have custom work that comes into our shop as well, which takes a creative mind. Not everybody has to come into this machine shop knowing everything about machining or what machining actually turns into. But if someone would come into this business with a open mind, with a creative mind, there is room to work with that person, and there's also ways to talk to that person about how they could probably further our business, more or less. Most of all of our product here goes straight to the United States government, which at that point goes straight to war, has successfully saved a lot of lives for the United States citizens. It also has saved a lot of families and brought a lot of the dire need of bringing this country back to a safe zone, more or less. Our company has received a lot of different certifications for the United States government, has also received a lot of awards for the United States government as well for being a top vendor. A lot of that just came because we have the will to want to work, and we have the will to provide a safe and a need to make a product that is not going to fail out in the field. None of that came real easily, only because we had people that were here that were willing to put the warfighter first and not necessarily thinking about their paycheck at the end of the day, or thinking that, you know, I just need to get out of work quickly as possible. They were putting the warfighter ahead of their schedule and ahead of their priorities. More or less, that has been what this business has been built around. We're third generation at this point, running 60 years in business currently. My brother and myself are the third generation. We have started from a nut and bolt business up to a defense contracting company and one of the leading providers for the United States government. At this point, we've been struggling to try to find qualified employees to help us continue to benefit the United States government. And it's not necessarily because of their lack of knowledge, it's their will to want to work. And we're really trying to find those people that want to make a difference in this country and even in our local communities. If we could even have people come in and just have an open mind and see the things that we're doing here, we would appreciate any sort of knowledge that you can bring in from the outside to our business, more or less. And my business is willing to work with any sort of individual that would be willing to lend a helping hand and maybe bring something great for this country. An ideal candidate for us would be somebody that is actually very handy. Someone that's willing to also get a little bit dirty at times, the education that we would require from somebody would be at least a high school degree. On top of that, if someone had some sort of machining background or went to a trade school that had some sort of knowledge, even if it wasn't even for machining, if it was even for auto mechanics or some sort of hands-on type of training, that could all be applied to machine shop. Even though it may not be the same kind of qualifications that we'd be looking for, the will to use your hands and actually produce a product, whether it's a machining or if it's on a car, could actually be applied to the same kind of qualifications what we're looking for here. We also have an area where there's a little bit of design work going on, so somebody that's capable of using a computer, able to use CAD drawings, making different types of drawings for this company to develop new products would be definitely beneficial for us. So someone that has some sort of computer education would be great. Not also required, but it would help us. Somebody that's willing to even take out the garbage for us at times or sweep the floors. You'll often see my brother and myself doing something similar to that. So not only would the employer be doing the same thing as an employee may be doing, but we're all here as a team trying to work together. So there's not a person that we would probably say that we would turn down without having the lack of education, but just we need the people that have the will to want to work. So general compensation for a company like ours ranges anywhere from $15 an hour up to about $20 an hour. We also give full benefits, which is health insurance that's 100% paid by this business. We have a 401k package as well. There is also room to work with that hourly wage as well, depending on what kind of work ethic comes into this business, what kind of work we can see from an employee, and what other kind of trade you can bring to us that we can maybe be involved in different types of skills or different types of patterns of work, not necessarily with the government. Maybe it could be something totally new that you came in with an invention that we could turn around and market and sell. Even bringing something into that like us, bring something like that to us could also incline in a compensation for somebody. So when people think about machine shops, they think about what it was like when the steel mills were around. Very dirty, very dangerous. People were getting cut. People were getting hurt on the jobs. They were getting worked very hard, more or less. At this point now, machine shops have evolved into something that's very computer-backed. The computers actually help generate most of these programs and these types of parts are being made. So at this point, people look at machine shops as thinking that's a low-level job, that's something that somebody did 100 years ago. But at this point now, it's actually on the cutting edge at this point. And you'll see a lot of this type of work on some of your famous car shows or motorcycle companies and stuff like that are using the same technology that we're using here at General Manufacturing. There's products here that you would come in and see that are being made that could be used in several different types of industries. So at this point, the machine shop itself is no longer maybe a lower on the totem pole or not needed. At this point, it is a highly needed skill, and it's also a skill that could take you to a level of being a very respectable person. It's not as labor intensive as it used to be at one point. As I had mentioned, there was the machining back in the day. It used to be very unsafe. People would get stuck in the machine or lose a finger or potentially get their shirt caught in the machine. With a new type of equipment that we have, everything's enclosed. We have, at this point, have a very low to none existent of cuts or bruises or any sort of damage to the actual human being itself. We've made a safe environment for everybody. We have no workman's comps claims at this point in the 60 years we've been around. But the labor itself is not as hard as everyone would perceive it to be at this point. So, you know, the way the machine shops used to be previous years, maybe 100 years ago, you would probably last in a machine shop for 15 to 20 years before your body would totally break down. Your knees would fall apart. Your backs would fall apart. Anymore at this point, there is some standing that goes on, so there might be a little bit of strain on your back, but you know, we've seen people in this industry, and at this point now, we have employed people for over 30 years that are healthy people that are able to you know, still go home and play baseball with their kids and run out and show their children how to ride a bicycle still. They're no longer the type of machinist that would go home and lay on the couch for the whole weekend to try to recoup from how bad work was at one point. This is definitely a less of an invasive type machine shop than what previously used to be around. My company has also not been opposed to, you know, training people for the several years they may have worked here for, and some of those gentlemen or possibly women have moved on and started their own businesses because of what they've learned at this business. This is a business that is actually growing. There's a lot of need for a machine shop, but there's not a lot of people that are willing to help. But if there is people willing to help, I've seen a lot of other companies that have started from companies like mine. Employees came here and worked, and they were here for maybe a year, maybe they were here for 20 years, and they've at that point had quit, and maybe they started their own businesses. They started their own machine shop and been very successful. I don't look at that as competition, but I look at that as there's enough work for everybody at that point.